Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Killing Bridezilla by Laura Levine, narrated by Brittany Pressley.
Chapter 1. Some people look back on their high school days fondly, lost in happy memories of pep rallies and senior proms. And then there are the other 98% of us. For us, high school was hell with acne. A blistering nook of inferno Dante neglected to mention, where we first discovered that life isn't fair and blondes really do have more fun. Which is why I cringed when I first got that call from Patti Marshall. In the Dante-esque world of high school, Patti was Satan's ringmaster. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Let me back up and set the scene. I'd just come home from the vet, where I'd taken my cat Prozac for her annual checkup. You'll be happy to learn Prozac was in perfect health. The vet, however, required several stitches and a trip to the emergency room. "How could you attack poor Dr. Graham like that?" I scolded as I let her out of her cage. "I warned her to stay away from my privates." "I still can't believe you bit her in the arm." "Me neither. I was aiming for her face." I poured myself a wee tankard of Chardonnay to recuperate and was reaching for a restorative dose of Oreos when the phone rang. Too wiped out to answer, I let the machine get it. "Jaine, it's Patti Marshall." I froze in my tracks. Patti had been the queen bee of my alma mater, Hermosa High School. A social despot who ruled her subjects with a fine-tuned cruelty and a flawless complexion. Her voice drifted from the machine, the same nasal whine that had delivered so many devastating zingers in the girls' locker room. "I heard you're a writer now. Give me a call, okay? I think I may have some work for you." My palms turned clammy. Patti represented everything I'd loathed about high school. I could just picture her sitting at her throne at the popular table in the cafeteria, eyeing the unpopulars with undisguised disdain and leading her bitches-in-waiting in a chorus of derisive giggles. I would have liked nothing more than to zap her message to oblivion. But she'd said the magic word, work. A commodity I'm chronically short of. I turned to Prozac, who was sprawled out on the sofa, licking her prized privates. "What do you think, bro? She's a world-class rat, but I really need the money. What should I do?" She looked up at me with big green eyes that seemed to say, "It's always about you, isn't it? What about me? When do I eat?" Which goes a long way toward explaining why man's best friend has never been the cat. Oh well, I really needed the dough, so I took a bracing gulp of Chardonnay and forced myself to give Patti a call.
"Hi, Jaine,"
she trilled when she came on the line.
"How've you been?"
Somewhat stunned by the friendly lilt to her voice, I mumbled, fine.
"Listen, I've got great news. I'm getting married."
Congratulations. I didn't envy the poor guy headed down that aisle.
"Anyhow, I need somebody to write my wedding vows. I heard you're a writer now, and I thought it'd be great to work with an old friend."
An old friend? The woman was clearly smoking something illegal.
"So, what have you written? Anything I've heard of?"
As a matter of fact, I had written an ad she might very well have heard of, or at least seen. It's been on bus stops all over town. But it wasn't exactly the kind of ad that leaves people awestruck. I wrote, "In a rush to flush, call toilet masters." I waited for Patti's patented, "Ew, gross," the line which she tarred many a fragile ego at Hermosa High. But instead, I heard,
"Really? I saw that in the yellow pages. It's very cute."
Alert the media. A compliment from Catty Patti.
"So, how about it, Jaine? You think you'd be interested?" Well, I was thinking of paying somewhere in the neighborhood of $3,000. Call the movers. That was my kind of neighborhood. That sounds terrific, Patty. I'd love to do it. Wonderful, she gushed. I know we're going to have so much fun. We agreed to meet the next day, and I hung up, not quite believing what had just happened. This certainly wasn't the same Queen of Mean I'd known in high school. Was it possible Patty had changed over the years? Why not? People changed all the time. I had to stop being such a cynic and give her the benefit of the doubt. Somewhere along the line, Patty Marshall had obviously morphed into a decent human being. And more important, a decent human being who was willing to enrich my bank balance by $3,000. And so, I embarked on my new assignment filled with hope and good cheer, much like, I imagine, Dr. Graham must have felt before reaching for Prozac's privates. Chapter 2. I arranged to meet Patty the next day at her parents' home in Bel Air. Back in Hermosa, Patty had lived in a fabulous beachfront house, a gleaming white affair with unobstructed views of the Pacific. A house, needless to say, I'd never been invited to. As nice as Patty's Hermosa house had been, it was a virtual shack compared to her new digs in Bel Air. As I drove up the leafy pathway to the estate, a sprawling manse with more wings than a condo complex, I could practically smell the scent of freshly minted money in the air. I parked my ancient Corolla in the motor court and checked my reflection in the rearview mirror. It was a glorious day, sunny and clear, and I was grateful that my hair, which usually turns to Brillo at the first sign of humidity, was mercifully frizz-free. I fluffed it into what I hoped was a Sarah Jessica Parker-ish nimbus of curls, then sucked in my gut and headed for the front door. A Hispanic maid in a starched white apron answered the bell. "I'm here to see Patty," I said. "I'm Jaine Austen, her writer." "Another one?" She rolled her eyes and ushered me into a foyer bigger than my living room, complete with double marble staircase and a crystal chandelier the size of a Volkswagen. "Miss Patty," she called up the steps. "The rider lady is here." Patty's voice drifted from above. "I'll be right down."
"Good luck." The maid shot me a sympathetic smile and scurried away. I was standing there, counting the crystals in the chandelier, when I heard the clack of heels on the marble stairs. I looked up, and there she was, Patty Marshall, Hermosa High's very own Cruella de Vil. I'd been hoping she'd put on a few pounds since high school like the rest of us mere mortals. But if anything, she'd lost weight. Life sure isn't fair, isn't it? Unlike most high school prima donnas, Patty had never been a conventional beauty. Her face was a little too long, her eyes just a little too close together. But there was something about the way she carried herself, the way she looked at you through those close-set eyes, that had you convinced she was a stunner. She made her grand entrance now, sweeping down the stairs in body-hugging capris and a tank top. Her gleaming blonde hair, always her best feature, was caught up in a careless ponytail that swished from side to side as she walked. In the crook of her arm, she carried what at first looked like a large cotton ball, but when the cotton ball started yapping, I realized it was a dog.
"Jaine, sweetie," she beamed. "It's so good to see you again."
As she wrapped me in a bony, one-armed hug, her dog began licking my face with all the abandon of a co-ed gone wild.
"Mamie really likes you, Jaine."
Either that, or she smelled the quarter-pounder I'd had for lunch.
"It's time you two were properly introduced."
She held out the dog, and I now saw that they were wearing matching pink tank tops, embroidered with the logo, "I'm cute, buy me something."
"Jaine, say hello to Mamie."
She smiled at me expectantly. Oh, good heavens. She actually wanted me to say hello to her dog. Hello, Mamie. I managed a feeble smile. Mamie, having clearly decided I was her new best friend, squirmed in Patty's arms, eager to unleash her salivary glands on me.
I hardly ever let anybody do this,
Patty intoned, with all the solemnity of King Arthur bestowing a knighthood.
But you can hold her.
With that, she thrust the dog in my arms, and within seconds, I was covered in an aromatic layer of dog spit.
Let's go out to the patio, and I'll tell you all about your assignment.
She guided me past a maze of impeccably decorated rooms, and then out through French doors, to a bit of paradise that would give the Garden of Eden a run for its money. I gazed in awe at the plushy, furnished patio, complete with built-in Viking barbecue. The Olympic-caliber lap pool, and the tennis courts in the distance. All of it surrounded by velvety green lawns, exquisitely tended flower beds, and a small forest of trees.
Want something to eat?
Patty asked, plopping down onto a chaise lounge.
I'm starved.
Sure, I said, hoping for something whose main ingredient was chocolate. Hey, Rosa! She barked into an intercom on an end table.
Bring us some Evian and carrot sticks.
Oh, foo. Not exactly the snack I'd been hoping for. So what happened to your house in Hermosa Beach? I asked, easing myself into a pillowy armchair, still holding Mamie, who was now busy nibbling on my ears.
Oh, Mom sold it when she married Connie.
Connie? I blinked in surprise. I remembered Patty's mom, a va-va-va-voom blonde with a nipped-in waist and man-made bosoms. And somehow, I couldn't picture her hooked up with someone of the female persuasion.
Short for Conrad. Conrad Devane, my stepfather.
Where is your dad?
Oh, Daddy died about 10 years ago. Guess he figured it was easier than living with Mom. He wasn't dead in his grave 2 weeks before Mom sank her claws into Connie. She knows how to sniff out the rich ones. Not that it mattered to me. Daddy left me a bundle.
She smiled proudly, as if inheriting money was a major life accomplishment.
Anyhow, we decided to have the wedding here at the house. It's so much cozier than a hotel, don't you think?
Was she kidding? This place was a hotel.
We'll have the ceremony out on the lawn. It should be utterly glorious.
She stretched out on the chaise, then shrieked,
Hey, Rosa! Where the hell's our food? Oh, there you are. It's about time.
I looked up to see the harried maid scurrying to our side with two frosty bottles of Evian and carrot sticks, beautifully arranged in a cut glass bowl. Patty grabbed an Evian from the tray and pouted.
Yuck! Rosa, this water's too cold. How many times do I have to tell you I want it chilled, not icy?
Shall I bring you another, Miss Patty?
Rosa asked through gritted teeth.
Oh, forget it, Patty said with an irritated wave. Just go.
More than happy to escape, Rosa scooted back into the house. As I watched her retreating figure, it occurred to me that perhaps I'd been a tad optimistic, thinking that Patty had miraculously morphed into a sweetheart since high school.
Like I said on the phone, she said, reaching for a carrot stick. I need somebody to help me write my wedding vows. You wouldn't believe how many writers I've been through.
After the little scene I'd just witnessed, I had no trouble believing it. None whatsoever.
I'm counting on you, Jaine, to come through for me.
The look in her eyes told me it wasn't so much a wish as a royal edict. What sort of vows were you thinking of?
I've had the most fabulous idea.
Her eyes lit up.
Instead of a traditional ceremony, I've decided to reenact the balcony scene from Romeo and Juliet.
Huh?
Only this time with a happy ending.
For a minute, I wondered if Mamie's spit in my ear had affected my hearing.
I'll be up on that balcony.
She pointed to an elaborate wrought iron balcony on the second story of the house.
My fiancé will stand below, and when I ask him to deny thy father and refuse thy name, he's going to say, okie dokie. And then, instead of all that gloomy, doomy suicide stuff, I'll come down and marry him. See? A happy ending.
By now, even Mamie's jaw was hanging open with disbelief. And for the first time, it hit me that Patti Marshall was an idiot. All those years at Hermosa High, we were terrorized by a prized num-num.
It's really a very simple assignment, Jaine. All you have to do is...
rewrite William Shakespeare?
Yes. Make it hip and modern. Isn't that the best idea ever?
Compared to what? The Spanish Inquisition?
Come on,
she said, jumping up from the chaise.
Let's go up to the balcony. Once you see how gorgeous it is, it'll put you in the mood to write.
The only thing that would put me in the mood to write this bilge would be a lobotomy. With Mamie still in my arms, I followed Patti back inside the house and up to her bedroom, a hot pink extravaganza, think Fleer's double bubble, that led out onto the balcony.
Inspirational, isn't it?
Patti gushed as we stepped outside. Very.
How do you like the railing?
I dutifully oohed and awed over the elaborate wrought iron scrollwork that bordered the balcony.
I had it imported all the way from Verona, Italy,
she beamed.
That's where the real Romeo and Juliet were born.
I didn't want to bust her bubble and tell her that Romeo and Juliet were fictional characters, so I just kept oohing and aahing.
The workmen just finished installing it yesterday, and I've ordered statues of Cupid that'll be scattered around the garden. Won't that be romantic?
Somehow I managed to nod yes, at which point she draped herself over the railing and, with great gusto, began mangling Shakespeare.
Romeo, Romeo, wherefore arest thou Romeo?
At the sound of this exceedingly bad line reading, Mamie let out a plaintive yowl, as did Shakespeare, no doubt, from his grave. I joined Patti at the railing and gazed down at the rolling green landscape below.
That's where Dickie proposed to me,
she said, pointing to a wooden gazebo nestled in a bower of trees.
The secret gazebo.
The secret gazebo?
We call it that because you can only see it from up here on the balcony. It's practically impossible to find down on the ground unless you know where it is.
A secret gazebo. How romantic.
I'll say, I've had some pretty kinky sex down there.
Luckily, she spared me the details. After assuring Patti that I'd been sufficiently inspired, we trooped back downstairs where she took Mamie from my drool-infested arms.
So, now you know the assignment, she said, with a toss of her ponytail. Just dash off a scene where Romeo proposes to me and I say yes. Only, of course, Juliet's name will be Patti and Romeo's name will be Dickie. And get rid of all the stuffy language. I want it to be snappy and sassy, like friends with swords and long dresses.
By now, I was on auto-nod, bobbing my head at everything she said, no matter how inane. 5 more minutes with her, and I'd need a neck brace.
Come on, she said. I'll walk you to your car.
We headed outside just in time to see a bright yellow VW Beetle pull up in the driveway.
Oh, look, it's Dickie.
A tall, sandy-haired guy untangled his long legs from the car.
Dickie, sweetie,
Patti cried, racing to his side. She threw her arms around his neck and locked her lips on his. When they finally came up for air, she said,
Honey, say hello to Jaine. I told you I hired her to write our wedding vows, didn't I? You remember Dickie, don't you, Jaine?
I looked up at her fiancé and took in his shy smile and spiky, slightly tousled hair. There was something about that smile of his that seemed familiar, but I couldn't quite place him. I'm afraid not.
It's Dickie Potter. He was in our class at Hermosa.
Dickie Potter? I blinked in surprise. The same Dickie Potter who played tuba in the marching band? He nodded. When I last saw Dickie Potter, he was a committed nerd, all knees and elbows, his face sprinkled with acne, someone Patty never would have looked at twice. But over the years, he'd blossomed into a major cutie.
What a change, huh?
Patty winked. Patty and I ran into each other at last year's Hermosa High reunion, Dickie said, gazing at her with a worshipful smile.
Yeah, he took one look at me, and the next thing I knew, he was divorcing his wife.
Patty giggled coyly, the happy homewrecker.
Poor Norma Lynn,
she said, without a trace of sympathy.
Didn't know what hit her.
Norma Lynn Butler? I asked, remembering a tall, gawky girl who played flute in the band. You were married to Norma Lynn? Yes. Dickie nodded ruefully. I'm really sorry it ended the way it did.
Oh, poo. I'm sure she's over it by now, Patty said,
waving away his doubts.
Well, it's time for Jaine to get out of here and leave us alone.
She threw her arms around him once more, clearly ready for some wild times in the gazebo.
It was nice seeing you, Dickie said to me over her shoulder.
Very nice, I said, eager to make my escape before the action got X-rated. I gave a feeble wave and was heading for my car when Patty called out to me.
You better not screw this up, Jaine, like you used to screw up in P.E.
Then she shot me the same demoralizing look she'd used so effectively all those years ago in the Hermosa High gym.
You're such a klutz.
Then she laughed a tinkly laugh for Dickie's benefit. She wanted him to think she was kidding, but she and I both knew better.
And don't take too long, she trilled. I want the script in my hands the day after tomorrow.
So much for Patty having changed. Whatever initial burst of goodwill she'd shown me was history. The bitch was back. I trudged up the path to my apartment, wondering how I was going to survive working for Patty, when I saw my neighbor Lance stretched out on a deck chair. Lance and I live in a modest duplex on the fringes of Beverly Hills, far from the mega mansions to the north and just a hop, skip, and jump away from the gangs to the south. It's a neat old 1940s building where the rent is reasonable and the plumbing impossible. Hey, Jaine, Lance said, his blonde curls glinting in the sun. How's it going?
Don't ask, I grunted.
Come here, he said, patting his chair. Tell Uncle Lance all about it. Lance works odd hours as a shoe salesman at Neiman Marcus, which is why he can often be found lolling about on deck chairs in the middle of the day. I plopped down next to him, and he put a comforting arm around my shoulder, an arm he promptly jerked away.
Yuck! Why are you wet? Ugh, and you smell funny.
It's dog spit, one of the perks of my new job, I sighed. I just got the assignment from hell, writing for a ghastly woman I used to go to high school with. A world-class bitch, the queen of mean. Any chance she's gained oodles of weight and grown a mustache since high school? I shook my head, dispirited. Patty's actually thinner than she was back then.
That's because the mean gene burns calories. That's your problem, Jaine, he said, glancing at my thighs. You're way too nice.
She actually wants me to rewrite Shakespeare. She wants me to make it snappy, like friends with swords and long dresses.
Why don't you just turn down the job?
Oh, I don't know.
I was hoping to spend the money on a few luxuries like food and rent. Poor baby, he tisked. Know what you need? A nice frosty margarita. Come on, let's go to my apartment and I'll make you one.
With a big bowl of chips.
Great, I said, my taste buds springing to life. Oh, wait, I just remembered. I'm all out of tequila. And margarita mix. And chips, too, for that matter. 5 minutes later, we were sitting in my living room feasting on lukewarm snapples and leftover martini olives. It's funny, I said, sucking on a pimento. You spend decades trying to forget how miserable you were in high school, and then, after only a few minutes with the class dragon lady, it all comes flooding back. I took a desultory slurp of Snapple. I was so awkward in high school, I swear. I spent 4 years with the same damn zit on my chin. What about you? Were you a mess? Not really, Lance said with an apologetic shrug. I had my own set of problems, trying to explain to my dad why I wasn't reading Playboy and playing football, but I didn't go through an awkward phase. Prozac looked up from where she was nestled on Lance's lap.
Me neither. I've always been adorable.
You can't let this Patty creature make you feel bad about yourself, Lance said, with an indignant shake of his curls. You've got to do something to boost your self-confidence. His brow furrowed in thought. You know what you need? Yes, I said, a frosty margarita. But if memory serves, you're all out of tequila. You need a new look, an entire wardrobe makeover. His eyes shone with evangelical fervor. Lance has been dying to do a Henry Higgins on me for years. Forget it, Lance. I can't afford to go shopping. Okay, then. We'll do the next best thing. Closet therapy. With me as your closet therapist. My closet therapist? Yes. I'll get rid of all the ghastly clothes in your closet. You shouldn't be caught dead in, and then put together some adorable outfits, so you can show Patty what a hot number you really are. Really, Lance? I don't care what Patty thinks of me. Of course you do. Now come on, it's time for closet therapy. And with that, he took me by the arm and marched me to my bedroom closet. Gah! He cried, surveying its contents. It's worse than I remembered. For some odd reason, Lance is convinced I have terrible taste in clothes. According to him, moths come to my closet to commit suicide. Anyhow, here's how closet therapy works, he said, getting down to business. You make 3 piles, the clothes you're going to keep, the clothes you're going to give to charity, and the clothes so hideous even Goodwill won't take them. Are you ready to start? I nodded with a distinct lack of enthusiasm. Here we go. He grabbed a perfectly lovely striped blouse and held it up. Gah, polyester. He shuddered, tossing it onto the floor. Into the hideous pile. Oh my God, and look at this jacket. Where did you buy it? A Russian thrift shop? And a Cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs t-shirt? I may go blind. It shows you how much he knew. That t-shirt happened to be a collector's item. I plopped down on my bed and watched as he tossed one perfectly usable item of clothing after another onto the hideous pile until my closet was a graveyard of wire hangers. Are you sure you can't afford to go shopping? Lance said, surveying the wreckage. No, Lance, I can't. Well then, Houston, I think we've got a problem. He was staring at a lone cocktail dress that had survived the massacre when his cell phone rang. He checked his caller ID, then grabbed it eagerly. Hi, Kevin. Great to hear from you. When? Now? Sure, I'm not doing anything. I'll be right over. He hung up and turned to me, smiling sheepishly. Don't kill me, Jaine, but I've gotta go. I'm meeting Kevin at the movies. Did I tell you about Kevin? No? Well, I think he could be Mr. Right. We met the other night online at the yogurt parlor. He's a non-fat cherry vanilla, just like me. Don't worry, he said, waving to the mountain of clothing in the hideous pile. I'll help you clean up this mess later tonight. Well, maybe not tonight, but tomorrow for sure. Or the day after. And with that, he blew out the door so fast he practically left exhaust fumes. I got up with a sigh and plucked Prozac from where she was napping on the hideous pile. Then, one by one, I began hanging my fashion rejects back in my closet. When I was all done, I caught my reflection in the mirror on the back of the closet door. There, on my chin, was the start of a blockbuster zit. Yep, it was beginning to feel a lot like high school. Chapter 3. It wasn't easy turning Romeo and Juliet into an episode of Friends, but with a positive attitude and a fistful of Excedrin, somehow I managed it. 2 days later, I had the finished pages in my hot little hands and set out to deliver them to Patti. We'd arranged to meet at the bridal salon where she and her bridesmaids were being fitted for their gowns.
"You'll never guess who my bridesmaids are," she'd said on the phone when we'd set up the date. "Cheryl and Denise."
Oh, yuck. Cheryl Hogan and Denise Gilbert were Patti's two best friends from high school. Denise, a striking brunette, and Cheryl, a delicate blonde with enormous Betty Boop eyes. Together with Patti, they formed a most unholy alliance. The terrible trinity, I used to call them. They had this way of collectively scanning you, zeroing in on your latest zit or bad hair day with the unerring accuracy of an MRI.
"Won't it be fun?" Patti had gushed. "The four of us getting together again."
Yeah, right. About as much fun as gastric bypass surgery. I made my way over to Cynthia's bridal salon in the Tony Montana Avenue section of Santa Monica, where the valet parking cost more than my car. I circled the block a few zillion times, searching for a space on the street, but there hasn't been an open parking space on Montana since D.W. Griffith was shooting Birth of a Nation. So eventually, I had to admit defeat and toss my keys to the valet. He drove off with a frightening squeal, and I walked the few steps to Cynthia's, my palms gushing sweat. I told myself I was being ridiculous. I couldn't let the terrible trinity intimidate me anymore. It had been almost 20 years since graduation. I was an award-winning writer with an impressive career writing toilet bowl ads. Okay, so maybe writing toilet bowl ads wasn't so impressive. And maybe the only award I'd ever won was the Golden Plunger Award from the Los Angeles Plumbers Association. But it paid the rent, didn't it? Well, not always. Sometimes I had to get cash advances on my credit card, which reminded me, if I didn't pay my MasterCard bill soon, I'd be hit with another late fee. And ditto for my Nordstrom bill. And Bloomingdale's. Not to mention the bills from the phone company and my dentist. By now, I was in a funk just thinking of all the money I owed. All I can say is it's a good thing I don't make my living giving pep talks. With a weary sigh, I pushed open Cynthia's country French doors and headed inside. Cynthia's was a plush cocoon of ankle-deep carpeting and flattering lighting. Soothing classical music tinkled in the lavender-scented air. I looked around and was relieved to see that Patti was the only customer in the store. Maybe there'd been a change of plans, and Cheryl and Denise weren't going to be there after all. Patti stood on a raised platform in her wedding gown, a frou-frou Renaissance-inspired number, with a low-cut bodice, puffy sleeves, and enough material in the train to upholster a hotel lobby. A seamstress knelt at her feet, pins in her mouth, making alterations, while an elegant older woman, her silver hair swept back in a chignon, stood by with a nervous smile on her face.
"Cynthia, how many times do I have to tell you?" Patti snapped. "I want the bodice lower."
Was she insane? If that dress were cut any lower, It would be a belt.
Are you sure?
The silver-haired woman asked, a noticeable tick in her left eye.
Yes, I'm sure. I paid good money for these boobs. I want everyone to see them.
She then turned and saw me.
Oh, hi, Jaine. You have the script?
Right here, I said, waving the pages. I think it turned out very well.
I'll be the judge of that.
And at that moment, I knew without a doubt that I'd be rewriting this script right up until she and Dickie said I do. Sweating bullets for every one of those $3,000.
I was standing there, wondering if it was worth it, when a stunning brunette stepped out of one of the dressing rooms.
With a sinking sensation, I realized it was Denise Gilbert. The dewy good looks of her youth had been replaced by an air of sleek sophistication. But basically, she was the same beauty she'd always been, only thinner. Was there no justice in the world? Was I the only Hermosa High grad who'd packed on a pound or two?
What do you think, Patti?
She asked, twirling around in her dress. It's not easy to look chic in a bridesmaid's dress with big puffy sleeves and a bow in back, but somehow Denise managed to pull it off. Patty's eyes narrowed.
The bow needs to be bigger.
But Miss Marshall, Cynthia protested, if we make it any bigger, it's not going to be very flattering.
Of course it wouldn't. That's why Patti asked for it. You didn't have to be Siggy Freud to figure out that the last thing Patti wanted was to be upstaged by a stunning bridesmaid.
Besides, Cynthia said, her tick more noticeable than ever, I'm not sure we'll have time to import more fabric in time for the wedding.
Patti shot her a look that could melt steel.
Make time.
Yes, of course, of course.
By now, poor Cynthia's tick was out of control.
I'll go see to it now.
She and the seamstress scurried off into the back room, no doubt to hit the vodka bottle. Throughout the preceding exchange, Denise had just stood there, smiling pleasantly, her face an impassive mask.
Jaine, she said now, noticing me for the first time. Patti told me you'd be here. How nice to see you.
Her eyes raked me over. You haven't changed a bit. Translation? My God, she still has that same zit on her chin.
You either, I said.
So, how've you been?
Wonderful, she said. I'm an attorney now.
Thin and rich. How depressing.
And what about you, Jaine? What have you been up to?
As Patti probably told you, I'm a writer.
Yes, she did mention it. In a rush to flush, call toilet masters. How clever.
Was there just the tiniest trace of a snicker in her smile?
And what else is going on in your life?
Yes, Jaine, Patti chimed in. I meant to ask you, any men in your life? You married?
No, not married. I didn't tell them about my ex-husband. The blob. A guy who wore flip-flops to our wedding and watched ESPN during sex. Somehow I didn't think they'd be impressed.
Any boyfriends? Denise asked.
Yeah,
Patti echoed.
Any boyfriends?
They shot me laser beam looks, and suddenly I was back in the hallway at Hermosa High, wilting under their supercilious gazes, a newborn zit ablaze on my chin.
So, Jaine, what about it?
Patti wasn't about to let me off the hook.
Any special guy in your life?
As a matter of fact, yes. Where had that come from? The only special guy in my life was the Domino's delivery guy. I'm engaged to be married.
Huh?
To a doctor.
What the hell was I saying?
Yes, I persisted in my madness. A neurosurgeon. Maybe it was some form of Tourette's.
Right,
said Patti. She and Denise exchanged sidelong glances, skepticism oozing from their pores. They weren't buying any of this, not for a second.
Congratulations, Denise said dryly.
I just had the most wonderful idea,
Patti cooed, a nasty glint in her eye.
You and your neurosurgeon fiancé simply must come to my wedding.
Okay, no need to panic. I'd just tell her my fiancé was out of town. Yes, he was in Africa, helping sick Africans. I'd tell her I was flying there to join him, and we couldn't possibly make it to her wedding. The words that actually came out of my mouth, however, went something like this. Francois and I would be delighted to come to your wedding. Francois? Had I totally lost my mind? I was about to commit myself to the home for the terminally mendacious when a pudgy woman in a polyester jogging suit walked in the shop. She glanced around timidly, then waved when she spotted Patti and Denise. Patti took one look at her and went ballistic.
Cheryl!
She hissed.
You look awful!
Cheryl? Was this frumpy woman with frizzed-out hair the same delicate beauty I'd known in high school? At last, I'd run into someone who'd packed on some pounds since graduation. But for some reason, it didn't feel nearly as gratifying as I thought it would.
For crying out loud, Cheryl!
Patti snapped.
You promised you'd lose weight!
Cheryl stood there, red-faced with shame.
I'm sorry, Patti, I tried, really I did.
Did you eat all the Jenny Craig meals I sent?
Yes,
she murmured, eyes lowered like a kid called to the principal's office.
Probably all in one day,
Patti sneered.
You realize the wedding's next week?
Cheryl nodded.
You'll never lose the weight by then, and I can't possibly have a fat bridesmaid. You know what that means, don't you?
Cheryl nodded again.
You're out,
Patti said, with all the finesse of a guillotine beheading.
You're no longer in the wedding party.
I'm so sorry, Patti,
Cheryl mumbled, eyes still lowered.
You should be. Do you realize how difficult you're making things for me? Where the hell am I going to get another bridesmaid at this late date?
She gazed in my direction for the briefest instant, but then looked away, having clearly dismissed me as unsuitable wedding party material.
Oh, well,
she sighed, the bridal martyr.
I'll manage somehow. I always do.
At last, Cheryl looked up, and I saw that her big blue eyes, always her best feature, were blinking back tears. In spite of how mean she'd been in high school, I felt sorry for her. And actually, when I thought about it, Cheryl hadn't really been all that mean. It was always Patti who'd been the nasty one, the instigator. Cheryl and Denise had been more of a Greek chorus, backing her up in her many acts of torture. I had a fleeting impulse to put my arm around Cheryl and console her with the dusty almond joy in the bottom of my purse. But I didn't, of course. I had troubles enough of my own. In case you forgot, I had less than a week to find myself a fiancé, a neurosurgeon yet. Named Francois.
A neurosurgeon fiancé? Have you lost your mind?
I was sitting across from my best friend, Candy Tobolowski, at our favorite restaurant, Paco's Tacos, a colorful joint with burritos the size of cruise missiles.
How could you tell such a whopper?
Candy stared at me, wide-eyed.
Couldn't you have made him something more believable, like a dermatologist?
You're missing the point here, Candy. It doesn't matter what sort of doctor he is. What matters is he doesn't exist. I stared morosely at my chimichanga combo plate. Why the heck had I ordered such a calorie fest? I should be eating something sensible like Candy's mahi-mahi if I wanted to look decent for the wedding.
I still can't understand why you did it,
she said, taking a dainty bite of her fish. I don't know, I sighed. It was just like the time in high school when Patti and Denise cornered me in the locker room and asked me if I had a date for the prom. They knew I didn't, but they wanted to see me squirm. So I lied and said I had one.
How'd you weasel your way out of that?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.